Hi, my name is Max and I'm going to present our work titled Quad Layouts via Constrained T-Mesh Quantization. Quad meshes are useful in a variety of applications from animation to engineering. High quality quad meshes should be semi-regular, meaning that most vertices are incident to 4 quads, while only a few singularities are incident to a different number of quads. The edge strips that connect singularities are called separatrices. Ideally, they form connections in a meaningful way, like this separatrix that connects the balance 5 vertex on the left with the balance 3 vertex on the right of the mesh. Unfortunately, if the quad mesh generation algorithm does not explicitly try to form such good connections, separatrices may often barely miss other singularities and will then run a long distance, spiraling around the mesh before finally hitting another singularity. The base complex, which is formed by all separatrices, will then be very dense. Ideally, the quad meshes should have a simple base complex, or quad layout, consisting of few patches. Such layouts enable, for example, the approximation of the surface with few spline patches or the use of efficient multi-grid solvers. The creation of such quad layouts is the topic of this presentation. Some earlier works take as input a quad mesh and iteratively adjust the layout structure. One example is the work of Bommes and colleagues, who adjust some edge flows to remove certain helical connectivity patterns. Another one is the work of Tarini and colleagues, who work directly on the layout and iteratively reconnect layout edges directly. Unfortunately, such iterative methods that apply modifications in a greedy fashion may get stuck in local minima, which prevent further layout simplification. Other methods compute a layout from scratch. Two examples are the methods of Raza van der Zaka and colleagues and Pietroni and colleagues. Both compute a set of potential separatrices connecting the layout vertices. They then solve a binary program that selects a subset of the candidates using constraints to ensure the layout is valid. The success of these methods depends on the set of candidates. If it is too small, no valid solution may exist. The authors report good results, however, no guarantees can be given. Our method is similar in that we also create a layout from scratch. However, one crucial difference is that instead of explicitly enumerating possible separatrix candidates, we encode the layout via the quantization of a T-mesh, which can represent an infinite number of possible separatrices. Using a linear integer program, we can guarantee to always find a valid conforming layout. Our method is also related to the recent quad meshing algorithm of Kampen and colleagues, which also computes a quantization of a T-mesh in order to generate a quad mesh. Here's how the method works. Given a seamless parameterization, so parameterization which may have cuts, but the directions are consistent over these cuts, motorcycles are started at every singularity and traced along the isolines of the parameterization. The motorcycles stop as soon as they hit the trace of another motorcycle. The result is such a T-mesh, a partitioning of the surface into rectangular regions. The algorithm then assigns integer length to the arcs of the graph, ensuring that the sum on opposite sides of the patches is equal. Finally, an integer grip map parameterization is found by filling the patches with the prescribed number of quads. The assigned integer length are chosen to approximate the length in the input parameterization, which typically results in meshes with high element quality. However, it can also easily lead to these near misses of the separatrices that I showed in the beginning, which lead to dense layouts. We, too, want to assign integer lengths to the T-mesh, but will base our assignment on the resulting quad layout. So first, let us take a closer look at how the quantization of the T-mesh influences the layout of the resulting quad mesh. The quantization of the arcs provides constraints on where the layout vertices have to lie in a parameterization. Setting the bottom left corner to the origin, for example, then fixes the position of all layout vertices. Parameterizing the layout vertices on these integer positions yields an integer grid map. Using this parameterization to project the regular integer grid back onto the surface yields the final quad mesh. Since we are only interested in the layout given by the edge loops emerging from layout vertices, we can try to make the quantization as coarse as possible, such that all quads in the resulting quad mesh already correspond to the layout patches. We can go coarser than this by assigning zero lengths to some arcs. If these two arcs are quantized to zero, the two layout vertices lie on the same grid line in the parameterization domain. Thus, they are connected by an edge in the quad layout. Alternatively, we can assign zero length to these arcs. Then the vertices will now lie on the same vertical line in the parameterization, resulting in a slightly different layout. Going even coarser by assigning zero lengths to the arcs in both directions is not possible, as this would force the two layout vertices onto the same position in the parameterization. This would cause inverted or degenerate elements and thus prevent the extraction of a valid quad mesh. So, the interesting question is now, which arcs can we set to zero without creating invalid parameterizations or layouts with low quality? In our algorithm, the layout quality is controlled by one parameter that specifies the maximum deviation a separatrix may have compared to its original trace direction. If the user specifies an angle smaller than these angles here, those layouts may not be created. Note that in these two examples, the central separatrices connect the same vertices, but they correspond to different original directions. Thus, the deviation on the right layout is larger than on the left. Okay, so the goal of our method is, given a seamless parameterization and an angular bound alpha as input, compute a coarse quad layout in which every separatrix deviates from the isolines of the input parameterization by at most alpha. Our algorithm achieves this goal in three steps. First, we generate a T-mesh. Then, we specify constraints that enforce validity and quality. And finally, we find a quantization of the T-mesh that adheres to those constraints by solving an integer linear program. Let's start with the T-mesh. As already mentioned in the introduction, the T-mesh is constructed by tracing a motorcycle graph inside a given seamless parameterization by starting motorcycles at each layout vertex in all axis directions. In standard motorcycle graphs, the motorcycles are stopped at the first intersection with a trace of another motorcycle. The resulting graph is simple in the sense that it consists of few elements. However, this also makes it more difficult to argue about paths that connect singularities. So, in order to make our lives easier later when we set up constraints, we create a slightly more complex T-mesh by tracing further than just the first intersection. How far we trace depends on the angular bound specified by the user. We continue until we intersect a trace started from a layout vertex within the angular bound on the left side and on the right side of our trace. Why is this our stopping criterion? This stopping criterion will later enable us to set up constraints for the quantization in such a way that we generate either the separatrix connecting to the left vertex or to the right vertex, which are both within the angular bound, or we generate a separatrix that goes in between these two and thus also lies within the angular bound. How these constraints are set up will be discussed next. But first, this is how the motorcycle graph looks like with our new stopping criterion. Okay, now that we have a T-mesh, let's take a look at the constraints we set up. We distinguish between two types of constraints, validity constraints and layout constraints. The former guarantee that a valid result is generated, that is, they prevent layout vertices from falling onto each other. The latter guarantee that all separatrices stay within the user-given bound, so they may prevent such a layout if the deviation is too large. Starting with the validity constraints. We already saw that there are two possibilities to resolve this issue. We can add separation in horizontal or vertical direction. Since we are aiming for layouts with little separatrix deviation, we will always opt to separate in the direction the two vertices already have the greater distance in, so vertical separation in this case. So how do we do this? What we want to achieve here is to ensure that the leftmost vertex does not fall onto the same parameter as any of the others. To do so, we find the first intersection with a trace that started within the 90 degree sector centered around the horizontal trace, so this one. We can easily ensure that the vertex of the horizontal trace lies on a different parameterization by simply requiring that at least one of these horizontal arcs left of the intersection is quantized to 1. Then, obviously, all vertices further to the right are also separated in horizontal direction by at least 1. What about the vertex outside the sector? Well, they will be separated in the other direction by using the same strategy for one of the other traces that start at the left vertex. Okay, So this ensures that the resulting layout is valid. So let us continue with the layout constraints. If this arc is quantized to 0, the start vertex will lie on the same parametric line as the vertex to the left, resulting in a separatrix connecting the two layout vertices. However, this separatrix may deviate too much from the original direction. In that case, we need to prevent the separatrix from forming. We achieve this by requiring this arc to be quantized to at least 1 as well. This way, it must lie on the different parametric line and the two vertices are not connected anymore. By doing this for all intersections, no two layout vertices can be connected by a separatrix if the angle would be too large. Now that we know how to create the T-mesh and how to constrain the quantization such that the layout will be of high quality, the remaining question is how to find a quantization that actually adheres to these constraints. We do this using an integer linear program. The variables of the integer linear program are the quantizations for each arc, which all need to be integer and non-negative. For consistency, the patches of the T-mesh need to be rectangular, which means the sum of the arc quantizations on one side needs to be equal to the sum on the other side. This is a simple equality constraint. Validity and layout constraints both specify sets of arcs of which at least one needs to be quantized to at least one. This is easily transformed into a linear constraint that states that the sum of the quantizations of these arcs needs to be greater than or equal to 1. Finally, we need to find an objective which promotes coarse layouts. As briefly mentioned in the beginning, it makes sense to compute a quantization as small as possible, since that leads to quad meshes with few elements which we use as coarse quad layouts. Thus, we minimize a weighted sum of the quantization variables. As weight, we choose half the length of the two patches adjacent to the arc, or the one patch if there's only one. This way, the energy does not depend on how many arcs cross a region, and setting the bottom row of the arcs to 1 generates the same cost as setting the top row to 1. The cost then simply corresponds to the total length of the patches that are quantized to 1. We use the resulting layouts to generate quad meshes. Here are some results. The colors identify the patches of the layout. I did not mention this during the presentation, but we also support meshes with boundaries or feature edges, which can be seen here. Here are some statistics on these results. This is too much to go through completely, so let me just point out a few things. First, our experiments show that the angular bound is indeed adhered to. The left column shows the chosen parameter alpha, and the right shows the maximum deviation of a separatrix. However, while the maximum deviation is often close to the bound, the average deviation typically stays a lot lower. The other thing I quickly want to point out is that our method is quite fast. Construction of the T-mesh and solving the integer linear program takes less than half a second on a typical model. We compare our method with the quantized global parameterization algorithm of Compton and colleagues, who, similarly to us, create quad meshes by quantizing a T-mesh. However, the quantization tries to approximate the original length of the arcs and has no concern for the resulting layout. Thus, the resulting meshes typically have dense layouts, as can be seen here, where we chose a target edge length of 1% of the bounding box diagonal. One can try to get coarser layouts by choosing a larger target edge length, which results in coarser quad meshes. We created quad meshes for 5% and 20% of the bounding box diagonal and refined the resulting meshes to end up with a similar number of quads as on the left. We can see in the table that the separatrices quickly deviate from the intended direction as the target edge length is increased. Some separatrices deviate up to 82 degrees, which means they are almost orthogonal to the originally intended direction. For comparison, we generated quad meshes with our technique with varying angular bounds alpha ranging from 5 degree to 45 degree, and present the results with the most similar number of layout patches. Even our densest layout with angular bound of 5 degrees is a lot coarser, while also having a lower average and maximum separatrix deviation. The two coarser versions have a similar number of layout patches, but also a smaller separatrix deviation. The quality of the individual elements, as indicated by the average minimum scale Jacobian, is a bit better with QGP for the densest layout, but this comes at the cost of almost 10 times as many layout patches. In the other versions, our element quality is higher. The same general behavior can be observed on the fertility model, as well as on the bunny. Here, we compare the quality of the resulting integer grid parameterization with those of Pietroni and colleagues. The color shows the angular difference per triangle between the final parameterization and a given cross field that specifies the intended directions. With D, we state the average of these deviations over the whole mesh. We can see that with a similar number of patches, we achieve less deviation. The reason the number of patches is so large for the top right model is that the original result of Pietroni contains T-junctions, which we extended until the layout was conforming. Okay, to summarize, we presented an algorithm which generates coarse quad layouts. It guarantees to always find a valid solution and the layout will be free of T-junctions. Further, it can also guarantee that the layout separatrices stay within a user-specified angular bound around the original directions in the seamless parameterization. And lastly, all this is done quite fast. For future work, one interesting aspect to look into could be tracing the motorcycle graph directly in a cross field rather than a seamless parameterization. This comes with a few challenges. For example, it may not be possible to find a consistent and valid quantization for the given input, making our integer linear program infeasible. In these cases, it will be necessary to insert additional singularities as has been done before in similar settings. However, a guarantee on angular deviation of separatrices can probably not be given in this setting. Another opportunity for improvement could be the relocation of singularities in situations where the exact positioning is not important. Slightly moving the input layout vertices may move them into the valid region, which could lead to simpler layouts. Thanks for your attention.